You think you hate it now, but wait till you drive it.
The Kibbe and Friends Show.
What it is, bro?
Featuring Rob Kibbe.
I don't know how to put this, but I'm kind of a big deal.
Justin Corn Dog Cornette.
New guy's in the corner puking his guts out.
And show producer Bernie McPartland.
This is the DJ 3000, and it has three distinct varieties of inane chatter.
Talking cars.
Do you feel this vehicle is safe for highway travel?
Yes, I do.
Diving deep on the topics that matter most.
Just when I think you couldn't possibly be any dumber, you go and do something like this.
And totally redeem yourself!
And the Dukes of Hazzard. Available in iTunes, Stitcher, and whatever else it is you listen on.
Turn up the volume.
The Kibbe and Friends Show.
Kibbe and Friends Show, episode 129, the Thanksgiving edition show, available on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, iHeartRadio, YouTube, Instagram, and Patreon. This, of course, is our two-hour bonus show this month. This is hour one. Second hour is in Patreon. I am Rob Kibbe, joined here by co-host Justin Corndog Cornette, intrepid producer Bernie McPartland.
Yes.
Should we start just doing all the quotes from Planes, Trains, and Automobiles?
I was really hoping we could just skip to hour two, because that's the most fun.
You Owen? Get your lazy behind out of that truck. She's skinny, but she's strong. We're going to do something
unique. Baby came out sideways.
Baby, she's going to scream or nothing. Before we get into it, I have seen Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. I have it memorized, fully memorized. In preparing for today's show, I learned even more. How many times have you guys seen it?
It's on pause in my living room right now. What does that tell you?
Is that the first time?
No.
Okay, throughout your lifetime.
First time today.
First time today,
but 10, 12?
Corndog?
Yeah. I've probably seen it maybe anywhere from 8 to 10 times, but it has been many years since I've seen it, sat down and actually watched it. Used to, when I watched movies all the time, I've seen it, come on TBS or whatever.
Yeah.
This is the first time in quite a few years that I've seen it, especially from beginning to end. It was like watching it all over again. It was fresh again.
Okay. We're going to do something today that we have never done before. We're going to do an hour two bonus show on a review that's already been done in the past.
That's awesome.
This is new territory. It is a little bit of recycling, but there's no other way to do it because there is one Thanksgiving movie out there that matters. There's really only one. It's Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. We reviewed this in episode 51 back when this was the Kibbe and Finnegan show, and that will be a portion of what you hear in today's show and review. The hour two deep dive with Patreon will be full of quotes, movie facts, and a reenacted scene.
Sweet. Oh boy.
Which I have yet to bestow upon you, but I have prepared and I have music. And Corndog, you are playing the. You'll see.
This is scary.
You are going to love it. We have quite a bit for you. So this is the week before Thanksgiving that we record this. A little programming note. The last show of the month for us is always the Patreon Q&A show. That'll still be the case this month. But with SEMA in the rearview mirror and Thanksgiving coming up and being a late Thanksgiving, there's just only so many ways to cut it. So we got to run our Thanksgiving show this week. So you're going to get all of this, and you can listen to it again next week when you're driving to see the relatives you don't want to see. How does that sound? Very good.
Yeah.
We have many segments to get to prior to that. Do have some Thanksgiving trivia for you coming up. Have some automotive news coming up. But let's go ahead and start with some interesting news that I just learned when we picked up the Skyperoonie here. Corndog, you told me something nice happened to us. Rare.
Yeah. So John Schneider has a new book that he just released. I'm thinking it actually just started shipping out this week or last week or whatever, but it's called My Life, My Way. And Jamie Blaine reached out to us about helping with some of the information.
It was several months ago. Yeah.
Yeah. It was back during the summer. Basically just wanted someone to kind of help proofread some of the Dukes of Hazzard facts that are mentioned in the book. Mm-hmm. And so we went back and forth with him a number of times over some little tidbits here and there in the book. And so in the very back of the book, we are given thanks.
And really? So, wow.
Yeah.
That's great.
He lists a few people. You know, he starts with, you know, the producers and Guy Waldron and then Tyler Perry. And then, you know, so he goes down the list or whatever. And then I'm looking at it and it's a couple people that work with him there at the studios. And then it's Brian Mays, Nancy Brooks, Rob Kibbe, Justin Cornett, Scott Dickerson, Byron Cherry, Vicky Lazone, Carol Moore and Karen Bryant for their help on the hazard history and the making of the book.
So it's y'all and not us.
Bern is still on the phone here. Bern, yeah. Still there?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, still here.
That was not the point. Of course, the production gets the full credit because without Bernie, there's no show, and therefore Corndog and I couldn't have gone to the premiere of the book launch, which we did so last weekend.
Yeah, that was fun.
That was so good.
Great. Just food. Because I didn't go to his concert when he was here in the Metroplex. Just because I didn't go. Because I was said I'm going to go, and then I ducked down at the very last possible minute. He took notice, and this is what happens.
He mentioned it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm sure he did. Mm-hmm.
But mm-hmm. while he was signing Kibbe Lee, man, it was just so touching, the nice words that he had to say. No, I'm kidding. Mm-hmm. I did not know about that part in there. And really, I get no credit here. I was sent an email by a name I didn't even know. I immediately said, look, if you're looking for Dukes of Hazzard fact check, and especially if it's about the car, there's only one person you need to talk to. And I sent him to Corndog. I only talked to him like one or two more times after that. This is 100% you, man. So congrats to you, Corndog. Cool.
That is awesome.
Without you, because you were the one who actually got the email, I would have never known anything about it. So
that's true. I am the front door to the credit that is this
you
show.
You are the bridge. That is...
Are you guys fixing a hug or something?
I think if both of us are being totally honest, if we could go back and tell the 8-year-old versions of ourselves, like John Schneider's going to say thank you to you at some point in your life, you are going to, your pants.
You're writing.
So what do we do here? Should we get some copies of the book? Should we give them away?
I already have a book on the way. My wife ordered one off of Amazon. And if you go to John Schneider's pages, his Facebook pages, he's been pushing the book really hard. So you can find the link there if you wanted to. You could probably put it in the notes or whatever. But if you go to John Schneider's Facebook page, he's really been pushing it. So he gives links on where to go to buy the book. I think you can buy a digital copy or you can buy an actual paperback. And so we bought the paperback through Amazon, I believe it was. And so it should be here tomorrow. Jamie Blaine sent a PDF copy, and so I've got started reading it. And so from what I've read so far, you know, I've only read like the first maybe 30 pages just yesterday, and I like the way it's laid out. And I don't sit down and just read books, you know, and that's not really me, but I like the way it's laid out. You know, it's hard to hold my attention, and it's pretty interesting the way it's written. So
I have
it's
seen
kind of written like a movie would be produced, so... I'll just leave it at that.
Well, I've seen his YouTube channel. He's gotten a little more credit on there. He's gotten traction with a few videos, one in particular. But your wife had suggested maybe we try to get him back on, and we could do that, and maybe we can get some stuff to give away. That'd be cool. But that's neat. We're going to call that a team win.
For the Schneider swag.
For the Schneider swag. Mm-hmm. That happened this year. Tom Wopat and John Schneider came on to this show back-to-back.
They did.
I'm still moonwalking on that one. That's a good deal.
What happened to Daisy?
Wait, all right, do you want I'll the real answer? It was a, it was not a no, but it was a...
You're out of your mind.
It was a no. Yeah. It was effectively a no. Yeah. It was a when I get around to it type thing. Maybe she's basically selling her house. That's true.
I saw that.
It was for sale. Corndog, you got a car? Another one?
Yes, over the weekend, I went and bought pretty much kind of sight unseen a 68 Chrysler Newport four-door hardtop, Chrysler Newport Custom. It's a little bit different, not much. But my full intentions of buying this car was to yank out the 383, 727, and 8 3/4 rear end, and it will eventually find its way in my General Lee. And so, you know, it's a complete car.
Your real General Lee?
Yes.
That's right. Oh, yeah. You're not doing a clone anymore. You don't need to. You have a real one. Okay.
Right. You know, my car was cut up and everything, so it had no drivetrain whatsoever. I have a few 383s, but they're all blown apart and need total rebuilding and everything. And I'm hoping that maybe I'll get lucky and just do a little bit of work and, you know, just get it to where this one will run and drive good enough for now, and then maybe build an engine and then drop it in. Mm-hmm. But I'm a good ways away from that anyway. But yeah, the car's complete. So I'm hoping that, you know, I can part it out and sell bits and pieces here and there that are desirable for that body style car and actually pay for the car so that virtually I have nothing in an engine and transmission and possibly a rear end. I checked the rear end. It's like 2 inches wider than a 68 through 70 B body. Mm. So I may be able to make it work. I may not. Either way, it has a chunk in it. I don't know what gears are in it yet, but not bad for what I gave for it. So
just tell us, what'd you give for it?
$400.
$400. You think you can get your money back? Well, I hope you get there.
Even if I get half of it, you know? What I'll do is I'll go on eBay and I'll just type in 1968 Chrysler Newport Custom and then go to the parts and accessories, go to completed auctions and look at what actually sold and what's, mm-hmm. and I always list it from highest so that I see what's kind of maybe more valuable. And weird things like windshield wipers, the correct windshield wipers, you know, you get $75 for them. Well, that's $75. And so I'll pick it apart and I'll sell everything that will sell. Mm-hmm. And so even if I've got a nickel and dime it, then I will.
Does this end up in your Mopar graveyard in the back 40?
The lower 40,
yes.
Right now it's out in front because in front of my shop right now because Sunday afternoon I was out there with two big trash bags and 55-gallon trash bags and I was just throwing everything that was not car related in there. And the guy was an avid believer in keeping his spark plugs changed because I've counted that I've found so far is 24 spark plugs. And so I don't know why he wouldn't throw them away. I don't know if maybe he just, you know, put some sandpaper to them and reused them later. I don't know, but
were they all the same heat range? Was he putting nitrous shots on there and swapping plugs?
He's got rust shots on it right now because it's pretty bad. But he used AC Delco and Champion, so those are the only two that I've seen so far. 24, I think, is what I counted. So there was a toolbox in the trunk, mm-hmm. and I even did a video too before I opened it. You know, I did a video. I was like, maybe it'll be something cool in there, and I crack it open, and it's full of tools, but it's all like the 1980 version of Harbor Freight tools. You know, it's like the cheapest of cheap, mm-hmm. and but it's full of them. So I was going to try to save the toolbox, but as soon as you start to turn it over, it's the bottom of it's just rusted out completely. So it was still kind of cool to look through it and see what might be in there.
80s version of Harbor Freight. What would that be?
Montgomery Ward.
Yeah, Monkey Ward. There you go. Yeah. Good pull. Mm-hmm. That's what it would be. We can't get sued by them.
I did find a Craftsman, for whatever reason, 10 millimeter, but, you know, the infamous 10 millimeter wrench. So that was good to have because you're always going to need one.
I've got a friend here in Dallas. All he does since he retired, he was a middle school counselor for years and a car builder on the side. And all he does now, and he makes almost as good a money, is he collects tools from estate sales and out of people's trunks of cars that they buy. And he takes them back to his garage. He cleans them. He buffs them or sands the rough parts off of them where necessary. And he takes them to swap meets and sets up a display and makes an absolute killing. Hmm. And sells the rest of them on Facebook. And he's got in this community now that people buy and sell these tools back and forth. And it's everything from the Craftsman 10 millimeter to the Montgomery Ward to the Harbor Freight. He's got them all categorized. He knows exactly what they're worth and what they'll bring, you know, almost down to the socket. You might look into that. Wow. He's doing quite well. It's really cool.
Between you, Bernie, and your love for picking and corn dogs picking for picking, we could start a new show on the network. That should make money. Called
Podcast Picking.
Podcast Picking. Sell your way to greatness by screwing guys over when you buy their dream car for $400. Where did you find? Was it on Craigslist? Were you going there to buy something else?
It's a friend of mine up in, no one knows where this is, but it's just outside of Yazoo City, if anybody around here is listening. But I've actually purchased three cars from him now and one engine. The picture that I posted on Instagram is right outside his driveway. You pull off a paved road and you go like 3 or 4 miles down a gravel road. And it's the one where, you know, you've got an embankment on both sides and it's an old, old road. Every time I've left his driveway, I'll pull down maybe about a mile and there's a good spot where it's like a 15 feet embankment on both sides. And I always take a picture right there. And so I bought that car from him. I bought a 73 Charger and a 73 Satellite and a 340 engine. Man. Over the last couple of years.
That's awesome. Yeah, you guys should go do a pick and show. You don't need me for that one. I'm good at buying things after the fact, after somebody's done the picking.
Well, yeah. Swap meets are so much fun anyway because they are, it's either rusty header day, it's intake manifold day, it's alternator day, or fender day, you know, the ones up here. You go and it's, they have an abundance of one or the other, depending on what swap meet you go to and what day it's on. And there's not much else. But if you're looking for one of those, then handy Edelbrock carburetor intakes are $10 a piece and ripe for the picking. Alternators are $1, and it's the same thing almost all the time. So if you know what you're looking for, you can get a deal. And if you don't, you buy Fury.
Yeah.
Well, there you go. Mm-hmm.
Before we roll on to the news here, which will be presented, of course, by Holly, I did go on a quest last week after the show to find the sound edit guy from the Dukes of Hazzard to get to the bottom of the fact of what the generally engine is. I don't have him yet, but I am getting there.
Cool.
Franklin Jones Jr. I believe that's the guy. I'm going to get him. I'm going to get
him. It's in California, the sound guy in California, right?
Yes. Yes, it is.
Okay.
I'm fairly certain that the... Well, this is my assumption, but just kind of based on putting us some other facts together. I don't think the engine sounds you hear in the show are from a Mopar at all. I think it's from a catalog suite of engines. Doesn't matter one way or the other. I just want the answer. But I am
so you I'm know close. What engine and exhaust to put in your car.
Yes. Yep. Whatever it takes, man. Whatever it takes. We're going to get there. All right, Bernie, should we go ahead and roll to the news presented by Holly?
Let's do that. Let's roll to the news. And I think probably... Everything I have here, you probably won't be news to us and probably not to many other people, but I think it is worth bearing. Like this, $31 million in the box office in its first weekend, plus you add in the concessions, including mine, that'd be about $100 million. Of course, talking Ford versus Ferrari. Mm-hmm. I saw it the other night. Have you guys seen it yet?
I sure did. Went last night.
Not yet. I think we're going to try to maybe go over Thanksgiving break. Holiday, whatever break.
You won't regret it.
Okay, I guess we should move on. I don't want to spoil it for him.
Nope.
Go ahead.
We're going to chat about a few things in there.
Does Ford win?
They do
win. Yes and no.
There's, yes and no. If you know this based story, on, there's nothing here you're going to learn because this is historical. And right. While there are some things that are liberties are taken to make a good movie, the outcome is as it truly happened. Both good and bad and, you know, fun and sad. That's all true. Interesting enough, the Holly mention that I made here came in the movie. Bernie, did you catch it?
Yes, I did.
So Holly is the air and fuel delivery system of the Kibbe and Friends show. Did you know it was also Carol Shelby's air and fuel delivery system?
Really?
So the famous thing was that he took the Ford 289, hopped it up, and he hopped it up with a number of goodies, including, I think it was a Holly 715. Not a 750, but a 715 CFM carburetor. And that would put the little 289 over 300 horse, and a number of kind of nice things happen. But on the GT40, when driver Ken Miles was out trying to figure out what Ford had done or had not done to this car, he was having all sorts of secondary problems. And he comes in and he says, the secondaries aren't acting in right away. I need this, this. And then you hear the engineer say, well, yeah, that's the Holly carburetor. Let's go get the Holly. Right there in the movie. And that's what was so good about Bernie. We won't spoil it for him. What was your hot take? So how much money did it make this weekend?
I mean, 31 it's only 4 days.
31 million. Oh, I'd read somewhere that it did almost that much internationally. So it's halfway to its budget. Its budget was $95 million, I think. What was your hot take?
I was hoping what I saw was what I saw. In other words, I was glad I saw what I saw. It's just one of those great movies where you watch a film and a car show breaks out in the background, number one. So you get to see all the background cars. That's always fun for me. And I really got to learn something. I didn't know the whole Ken Miles story. If it was accurately portrayed, then that's pretty cool. I love the way that he was a father first and a car guy second.
Mm-hmm.
Through the movie, it's always clear, you know, family's number one, the kid is number one, and he always takes time for that. So I thought that was really, really cool. I also thought it was cool that that guy that boxed George Clooney in Oh Brother, Where Art Thou, when he boxed him in the Woolworths, he was in the movie. You know, the guy that was like that. I can't think of his name, but.
Which guy? I'm going to have to go look that one up. The one that I couldn't get out of my head was the engineer who was also in Apollo 13. And whenever he would speak, I would just keep hearing him saying, Apollo 13, it's all right. We still got 4 inches. As long as we don't lose one more, we'll be all right. And I kept hearing that over and over.
This is the guy with the big schnoz, shorter hair, but tall and lanky and a big schnoz. But he was the guy that was, you know, he fought George Clooney and threw him out of the Woolworth. And that's all I could picture when I saw him.
I think we're talking about the same guy. So last night, when I got home, I was telling my wife about it. And I said, you know, I almost think we should review this movie tomorrow night. And she goes, does Corn Dog go to movies?
And not really.
No, I don't think so. But I'm so glad to hear you are. I don't. It's worth seeing in the theater. I took my whole men's Bible study to it. We had 12 guys there. I had my son. My friend brought two of his sons. We had another guy brought his 16-year-old son. And if you see the whole movie, so it's Carroll Shelby. It's the story of everything Carroll did, why he was recruited by Ford to help Ford, and then all the BS he had to put up with to help Ford achieve their dream and really help him achieve his.
Right.
And he has been through the ringer. You do get an understanding of who Carroll was, that he himself was. Well, first of all, he was a pilot in World War II. He was part of the Flying Sergeants program. Like he and Chuck Yeager and other names that you would know, he was a pilot first. And then he was a racer, and he was a good racer. He himself won Le Mans. I'm trying to say it. I always want to say Le Mans, like a Pontiac, you know. But but he himself did win it until he literally got to the point where his heart was, he was going to die doing it. He had too many heart conditions, and then started the company. And then he has this friend, Ken Miles, who's British and a good mechanic, and he's the kind of guy who wins every battle but loses every war. Like he's in his mid-40s, he's never had the big break, and he's a phenomenal driver, but he's a dick in the movie. And whether he's like that in real life, I don't know. You'll have to see the movie to put it in context, but like you, Bernie, the part about me was his son being there. The actor who portrayed his son was also in a Quiet Place, and you know, this was shot a year and a half ago. That boy is now kind of hit puberty, and he's taller, and his face looks different, and my son is right at the end of his childhood. He's turning the corner to become a man. His voice hasn't changed yet. And, you know, his eyes are still big and wide. And that innocence and the way that a kid sees a father, that's, they never say it in the movie. And it's there the whole time. When he sees his dad losing his temper and he's just walking up with a soda pop just to watch his dad race. Like, it is wonderful from that sense. Here's what they didn't have in the movie. This is going to blow your doors off. They did not have any shooting, no knives, no nudity, no undertone of some political message, one side or the other, that they just wanted to beat into you. None of that. It's just a good movie. It's a good movie that happens to be about race cars. It's I truly loved it. Matt Damon and
Christian Bale.
Christian Bale, they Oscar caliber performances. It's great acting. It's a great set. I can't even tell you who the what songs are in it, but it's true composed music. It's a timeless movie. We'll be able to watch this movie for the next 30 years.
I sure want to see it again in the theaters to try to pick up now on things that I missed the first time around.
Me too. Yeah. There was only one time when all gearheads do it, when your eye, oop, you know, you suddenly get distracted by something that's out of time. Like I did see a B.F. Goodrich radial TA tread pattern. I'd like, well, you know, it's a movie.
My wife hates when I do that.
Now that you know it, you're going to see it as soon as you watch it, but something pulls into frame and like, oop, there it is. And Bernie, did you know that we've covered this story before? I totally forgot about it. It was like 3 years ago, the car that actually won, not Ken Miles' car, it was the number two car that was being restored by RK Motors. We did a full feature interview with them.
Yes.
Forgot all about it. I went back. Mm-hmm. I was actually Googling and I found it like on our our own website. I'm like, oh, wow.
Website here.
I was Googling myself and look what I found.
Looks pretty credible. I'll look into more there. Yes, that was good news. Again, Holly chooses Skibby and Friends, but they chose Carol Shelby first. So way to go, Holly.
Way to go.
Doing good stuff. Yeah. Holly's also awesome. In Muscle Car Place this week. Little feature interview there. What else is in the news?
I've seen this on Facebook, and they are absolutely rewriting the definition of dissing. It's Ford's electric Mustang SUV. Yeah, I said it. Mustang SUV. Ford's got a reveal coming out in L.A. Was it this week they were going to do that?
I think it's happened.
Yeah, it's already happened. I'm pretty sure. Actor, and I didn't know this guy, Idris Elba is going to be the spokesperson for the car and the upcoming commercials and stuff. And I think he was in Hobbs and Shaw. Is that right?
He's in a lot of stuff. He was in Hobbs and Shaw. He was in The Office. He was in Star Trek, whatever the third. He's a very famous actor.
I didn't recognize him by face, but I thought I'd recognize that name in the Hobbs and Shaw credits. But anyhow, it's being called kindly ugly. Those SOBs should have renamed it. And Rob, this is not the car, not the electric car we saw at SEMA. It's got Mustang taillights and it's a grill. Nissan. It's me.
When I saw the news, I assumed it was literally the electric Mustang that we saw at SEMA. It's not. It's an SUV. It has Mustang taillights, like you said. It does have a Mustang dash. It's not meant to be a rocket ship. I don't know why they did this.
I saw a meme today, and it was a picture of the, on the top was the, like the 75 Mustang 2, and then it had right below it, it had the new whatever electric Mustang, and then it had like a little quote coming out of the Mustang 2, and it says, I'm no longer the ugliest Mustang ever.
I saw that one. Yeah, I saw that. That's some of the kinder stuff, yeah.
Look, electric cars are coming. This is going to happen more and more. I just wasn't ready for this. It's not even close. Call it an Explorer. Who cares what you call it? Don't call it a Mustang.
Well, is this because everyone is ditching cars and going for SUVs, and so they thought we might as well go and do this? Are you trying to hybrid your best car into something you think you're going to lead the market with?
The whole point Ford made is they were ditching all their cars except one. Mm. And the one they were saving was the Mustang, because it was the only one worth saving.
And then this.
All right, keeping with the Ford theme, the Ford EcoBoost 400. Kyle Busch took home his second championship, one in 2015, one this year. That was kind of cool. I love Eminem, so I was happy to see him. And I'm sure you guys are on either side of the I hate Kyle Busch's fan club. But I don't know. It's a fast car. He won. Good for him.
He's a great talent. He can drive. I also like M&M's. Bought my first round of peanut Christmas M&M's. Delicious.
What's different? Are they just red and green?
And there's more Christmas cheer. Yes. And that's worth an extra dollar per bag. I don't care.
Except on December 26.
You know the best M&M's? They're not even the peanut ones. It's the mint ones. The red, white, and green ones. I stock up on those. Because you can only get them during the holidays.
And the red bag. Ones. The peanut butter one.
The almond ones. They rock. Because the peanut ones, and here's why, the peanut ones, you can put them in your mouth, you can eat them cold and frozen, and it's easy enough to suck all the chocolate off of them, but the peanut, after you do that, gets mushy. The almond does not.
What are you sucking the chocolate off of?
Off the M&Ms.
Until it gets mushy.
And that's it, the peanuts get mushy, they do, but the almonds do not. So you have like another snack. You've got the chocolatey goodness, then you get a crunchy finish instead of something, yeah.
I feel like we've covered this before. I think.
Oh, come on, damn it. Oh, that sounds good. Melt the chocolate inside the dash. That really ups the resale value.
Yeah. I think you're going to be okay here. They have a thin candy shell. Glad you didn't know that.
That's right. I remember. We covered this before. Okay. Is there any more news, or have we covered everything we need to know?
That's enough.
That's enough for today. And that concludes Bernie on the News. Thank you, Bernie. Intrepid reporter. Can see the little thing in your hat that says news.
Press.
Well, I have some Thanksgiving factoids for you, presented by WyoTech. Remember, go listen to episode 405 of Muscle Car Place if you'd like to hear the full WyoTech story. But you too, from 0 to 9 months, could go get yourself a new trade, a new career, and have an actual career path waiting for you at the end. From the oldest name in the book, well, one of the oldest names in the book, WyoTech. Go listen to episode 405. We will have, hopefully, a student, but probably a faculty member as well on Muscle Car Place before the year's end. That would be very, 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 very cool. I would love to have a student on. I know why you can't have students on all the time, because students say things. But that would just be awesome to understand how somebody chose that, how they made that decision. So
yeah,
it's been interesting getting feedback from different people. I've heard from more graduates than I ever expected, especially those that were really happy to hear that, you know, one of the original teachers is back in charge of the whole place. So that's pretty cool. Some Patreon news before some Thanksgiving factoids. Leon, I don't know how to say your last name, but he is a new patron of the show. Way to go there, Leon. Justin Helmendollar took his pledge, bumped it up to the next level. And that ain't bad. Justin, you are not going to regret that move. And Marcus Hurich, he is at our top level. He is a $10 patron. He comes in booming, shooting, and immediately eligible for the Patreon prize giveaway. And this last month, it was the official... Wait, Marcus, thank you. This last month, it was the Kibbe and Friends Generally Code 70 Tumblr, which is now available for sale from Nathan Warren. Here's some news for our Patreon patrons. The Tumblr is now available for purchase from Warren Customs. You will have to email Nathan Warren for that, but he has made it available. For Kibbe and Show Patreon supporters, it's $45. The retail price is $60. But why do we spend so much money on that? Because it's painted orange by hand.
Automotive paint is expensive, too.
And it's a big sucker, too. This is not just a Starbucks coffee mug. This is a huge, huge vessel.
Full-size tumbler. It's got white base coat. Well, it's got white, and then it's got the code 70 on it. Then it's got the hand-applied decals on it. All of those go on by hand, and then it's got clear that goes over that. Then he buffs the edges out, and then he packages it, and then he sends it to you. So that's available to Kibbe and Show Patreon supporters. We'll have a new giveaway this month. Maybe we'll have the John Schneider giveaway by this month. I'm not sure what the prize will be. But just wanted to thank those three people for joining us. Very much appreciated. You are the best.
Thank you very much.
It smells like paint still. And what is so cool about it, it's so big. You can use it and you can talk like Darth Vader when you are talking on the phone to telemarketers.
Yes.
If you want. This is kind of fun. Let me just do this for the show.
I left the lid off of mine and left it out of the box just because when you do get it, it's fresh. So it's got a little bit of a, yeah, it smells like paint. But see, I'm also kind of immune to it. So I don't know if mine still smells like that. But if you leave the lid off and everything, it will air out and then just the solvents are still evaporating from the clear. Mm-hmm. And that's what you're smelling. So it's not going to always smell like that. So.
And it's generally orange, right?
Don't forget about the Warren Customs logo on the bottom.
Trademark logo, yeah.
Trademark.
Is that hand-painted or is that a decal?
Yeah, that's a decal. But speaking of Warren Customs, in the news, prior to Thanksgiving facts, from Bernie from 2 weeks ago, police in Florida are looking for Bigfoot. Seriously, someone stole an 8-foot, 300-pound statue of Sasquatch from in front of the Boynton Beach mattress store last month. The store is called Mattress Monsters and owned by Anthony Quilia, and he is not going to take this lying down. He's reported to the cops and is giving media interviews, hoping someone will turn in the Bigfoot bandits. He does not think it was teenagers monkeying around. He says it's so heavy, it would take at least two men to uproot, carry, and load it into a large truck.
I think he's wrong. I think it could be teenagers because in high school we had a restaurant, Kip's Big Boy. You remember those? Did y'all have those?
Yeah. Mark's Big Boy is what we had, but yes.
Did it have the big boy out front, the big statue?
Also as featured in Austin Powers.
Yes. They used to steal that. The senior class would at our high school, and they would take it. And these are high school kids with pickup trucks with gun racks back in those days. And they would take it and take it to the high school and put it over the front door. So up on that big concrete ledge, you know, that if you jumped out of the second floor window, you could land on. So that sucker's 20-something feet up in the air, and those are high school kids doing that, unless there were some degenerate gym teachers that went along with them, but I don't think so. I don't know how heavy it was, but it looked heavy. So Sasquatch, I think with hair and bare feet, yes, it would be a task, but I think it could be done.
Sasquatch likes turkey? I'm trying to find some way to tie this back to Thanksgiving.
Definitely.
I'm sure. Yeah.
It doesn't care if it's turkey season or not.
You hear about the two clowns that were in the forest and they got hungry and they found a hunter. They killed the hunter and ate him. One clown said to the other, "Does this taste funny to you?"
No, Bernie, no.
Well, there was these two clowns, and they were out in the forest, and...
Oh, no, come on. All right. I like the dad jokes. I like that you go that route.
On a dad joke?
Let me give you a little Thanksgiving factoid, and then we're going to roll to a movie review.
Okay. Your show.
Did... Our
show. It's the kippy part.
Hey, we're in the book.
That's right.
Yeah, y'all are in the book. Way to go.
Moonwalk nice. Right on over here.
Is that why you got a colored shirt on today? Very nice. Corndog and I are just on the back row, t-shirting it up.
We both have John Schneider's cell number, right? I mean, it's there. Here's a little news for you. A Thanksgiving mix-up inspired the first TV dinners. This is a true thing. In 1953, a Swanson employee accidentally ordered a colossal shipment of Thanksgiving turkeys, 260 tons worth to be exact. To get rid of them all, salesman Jerry Thomas took inspiration from the prepared foods served on airlines. He came up with the idea of filling 5,000 aluminum trays with the turkey, along with cornbread, dressing, gravy, peas, and sweet potatoes to round out the meal. The 98-cent meals were a hit, especially with kids in increasingly busy households. I've heard variations of that before, but I guess I forgot it was really tied to Thanksgiving. Here's another one for you. About 46 million turkeys are cooked for Thanksgiving each year. Thanksgiving without turkey would be like Christmas without a tree. This is all from goodhousekeeping.com, of course. They know Thanksgiving. And most American families consider it equally blasphemous. While not super popular the rest of the year, turkey is a huge hit for the holidays, perhaps because it really serves a crowd. On Christmas, 22 million families host an encore with yet another turkey. Turns out the bird really is the word. Do you guys have turkey for Christmas too?
Yeah, but I prefer ham.
Me too. We have Swiss steak at Christmas. I love Swiss steak. I probably prefer ham on Thanksgiving as well. We always have turkey, but we also have ham. I usually like the ham more.
A little bit of turkey and a lot of ham.
And stuffing.
Mom and mother-in-law are getting a little, little advanced and have figured out how much they don't like to cook a big meal. So we've kind of changed Thanksgiving. We kind of go to a steakhouse now. You can get a Thanksgiving meal there, but the steak is so good. That's where I'm leaning the last couple of years. And we'll do a turkey at Christmas. But that or one of the chain stores, I won't name it because they're not paying us, but they have a chicken fried turkey plate. I've had that, and it's awesome. Three big slices of breast are about... a quarter inch or better thick. You get three of those, and they're chicken fried. It's fantastic.
The Butterball Turkey Talk Line answers almost 100,000 calls each season. So many people roast a big bird just once a year and understandably need a little help. In 2016, the company's popular Cooking Crisis Management team also introduced a 24-hour text message line for the lead-up into the big day. So if you're not wondering why the turkey isn't turning out quite the way you want it, fear not, help is just a call or a text message away. And if it gobbles back to you, it's still alive. Still alive.
A few more minutes.
And only male turkeys gobble. You know what my favorite part about Thanksgiving is? About getting together and all the people? It's eating pie the next morning for breakfast. Man, I love nice big piece of pecan.
You know what my parents used to always make with the leftovers? You know, they would get, and I don't know the combination exactly that they would do, but they would get the turkey, and they would get the dressing, and they would cook it together in a skillet, and you put it on a bun. And it was, like, so good. I don't know what else they would add to it, but it was always, that was my favorite part, was the leftover combo sandwich. Turkey dressing combo sandwich or whatever it's called.
But like a turkey that was really sandwich? Good. Oh, yeah, you said dressing. Really Bernie, do you say dressing or stuffing?
Dressing, because stuffing truly is stuffing. It's something that you've actually stuffed into the bird and cooked. And dressing can be something different.
We would say stuffing, and we don't put it in the turkey. Mm-hmm. It doesn't get stuffed anywhere. That's wrong.
It goes in a casserole dish.
Yeah, it really does. My sister Jen,
dressing.
Like, it's 3 part breadcrumbs, 18 parts butter. It's good eats.
Yep.
One dad joke, and we're rolling to the movie review. Let's have it.
Dad joke, good dad joke.
Well, you built it all up.
Well, I was going to try to think of another one, except the two that we did off air, but I guess those are good enough. What's another name for ghost poop?
What is another name for ghost poop?
Another boo-boo. Name for ghost poop. Boo-boo. Okay, that's a good one. The movie review is brought to you by Aluma Trailers. Aluma is proud to present the best Thanksgiving movie ever made, which was made 5 years before they went into business, it turns out. In 1986, John Hughes, the man, the master of holiday movies, and Ferris Bueller and really other 80s movie with a teenage but penchant with Chicago bent, he released maybe the best holiday movie ever made, including some of the Christmas movies with Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. This is the review done 2 years ago in episode 51 of, at that time, the Kibbe and Finnegan Show. Stay tuned for our second hour in Patreon, where if you like what you heard there, you are about to get blasphemied, to borrow a phrase, with even more after that. So, Bernie, go ahead and roll that here, and then we'll close the show out. Does that sound good?
Sounds good.
Okay, here it is from episode 51, Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. Did you watch this movie, Mike?
Word.
Okay, are you excited about this movie?
Oh, yeah.
This movie was written, directed, and produced by John Hughes. It was released on November 25th, 1987, and stars Steve Martin and John Candy. Mike, what is your summary review of the greatest Thanksgiving movie ever made, Planes, Trains, and Automobiles?
Well, Rob, this will not be a movie review. This will be a celebration of offbeat comedic genius. Allow me to begin with a short list of things which do not suck. Home Alone, National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation, Uncle Buck, The Great Outdoors, She's Having a Baby, Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, Some Kind of Wonderful, Ferris Bueller's Day Off, Pretty in Pink, Weird Science, National Lampoon's European Vacation, The Breakfast Club, Mr. Mom, 16 Candles, Savage Islands. These were all either written or directed by my man, John Hughes, featuring comedic heavyweights. What? And if you cannot laugh during any of these flicks, and especially Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, then you have no soul and are likely a ginger. Okay? I have been on some horrendous, soul-crushing, faith-stealing road trips from hell.
You have.
But what Neil...
You make a living at that.
But what Neil Page, as played by Steve Martin, goes through in an effort to get home to his family for Thanksgiving dinner makes all of those trips seem like a princess cruise. All right? Neil's an advertising exec. He's had a really bad day.
All right.
He's late for his flight home. He gets punked out of his cab to the airport by none other than Kevin Bacon, because Bacon is in half the movies ever filmed. Mm-hmm. And then Del Griffith, an annoying goof played by John Candy, steals Neil's second cab to the airport. As it turns out, both Neil and Del are on the same canceled flight from New York to Chicago, and thus begins a road trip to end all road trips. They share cabs, buses, trains, even a motel bed, all of which sets up classic comedy vehicles for dialogues such as this. Where's your other hand? Between two pillows. Those aren't pillows! Yeah. Neil's an overbearing jackass who takes his family slightly for granted while he works too hard and too often. And it feels like karma as he takes bum baths in dirty sink water and wipes his face with Del's tidy whities. Mm-hmm. He's punched out by a taxi dispatcher. He falls down a snow-covered hill. He hitches a ride in the back of a frozen food truck and in the bed of a Chevy C10 during a snowstorm. Mm-hmm. When he and Del finally get their own car, a dubious-looking Chrysler LeBaron that is oddly reminiscent of the family truckster from National Lampoon's Vacation,
just a bit,
they end up going the wrong way on the highway, crashing and having the car burst into flames. Again, the dialogue is timeless. Mm-hmm. He says we're going the wrong way. How does he know where we're going?
Yeah, how does he know? Oh, he's drunk.
At the end of the movie, the guys finally split up at a train station a short distance from home. As Neil rides the train home, he realizes that not only is the pain in the ass Del a good guy, that he's also all alone this holiday season. Mm-hmm. So Neil hops off the train and meets Del again, where Del admits he doesn't have a home, that his wife's been dead for nearly a decade.
Mm-hmm.
Neil feels bad, ends up bringing Del home with him. The boys end up walking hand in hand, or more specifically, hand on trunk, as they carry this giant trunk that's been present throughout the whole movie into Neil's house to celebrate the holiday. Which begs the question, what the hell was in that trunk the entire movie? Because they never really addressed that.
Isn't there a hypergenic pillow in there?
I don't know.
There is. The only thing I remember seeing come out of it is the hypergenic pillow.
Okay. All right. Now I know. I totally missed that all these years. So here's some bonus stuff for you.
Uh-huh.
All right. So there are a few cameos in this flick that will make any nostalgic 80s movie nerd geek out. And aside from Kevin Bacon, which is big. Mm-hmm. We're also treated to Michael McKean, who is best known as his work in This Is Spinal Tap.
Mm-hmm.
He plays the cop here that pulls over Neil and Del as they make their way home in the burned out Le Baron Flambe. And during the rental car scene, Neil sets some sort of record, because this is the 80s for F-bombs, when he curses out the same lady behind the counter who plays Grace in Ferris Bueller's Day Off.
Mm-hmm.
Principal secretary. All right. And here's just something you may get this. I don't think anyone else on the planet is going to figure this one out, because the guy's not on screen in this movie. But when Neil is dropped off by the bus in the rental car parking lot, as he's walking to find his car, you hear the bus driver's voice. And I don't know what he says, but it is the same voice of the brother in the bar scene from Weird Science. And the bar scene is where Anthony Michael Hall says, "Well, my nuts are halfway up my ass, but other than that, I'm perfect." It is the same brother. Go back and watch the other movie.
Is it really? What he says in this one is, "It's a wise Lincoln Town car, spot V5. Or
right.
Whatever it
right.
is.
So same dude. And how are all of these people connected? Everybody would be Bacon. They are all connected because John Hughes used a lot of the same people in all of his movies. He even used the same composer. If you pay attention to the music in Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, it is really similar to Ferris Bueller's Day Off, because it's the same composer, Ira Newborn.
Is it? Really? Wow, cool.
Yep. That's my half-assed review. I love this movie. And if you at all like Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, pick any one of those other movies from the list I started with at the beginning, because they're hysterical. And one more funny thing, on the last flight I took, I watched Brockmire, which stars Hank Azaria. It was on Delta, so I don't know where you find it, but it's hysterical and disturbing. Yeah, he plays a sportscaster trying to make a comeback,
mm-hmm.
and I won't tell you anything else but that. It's hysterical.
Oh, I'll check that out. I like Hank Azaria a lot.
He's funny.
How many turkey drumsticks do you give this one?
Oh, God, I forgot all about that part. This is not my favorite of the Hughes movies, but it's up there. I'll give it an 8.
Give it an 8. Solid 8. Turkey gravy-covered drumsticks. Excellent review. Lots of effort in there.
A little bit of mashed potatoes stuck to the side of the drumstick, because that's what happens.
It makes it good. So, a little bit of money trivia. So, when this released in 1987, it had a $30 million budget. It did $49.5 million at the box office. So, a success. That's about $105 million today. I tried to go look up how it compared to other Thanksgiving, like big Thanksgiving movie releases. But the problem is you go up against like Star Wars or something. There really aren't other Thanksgiving movies to compare it to. So
there's not a lot of Thanksgiving movies.
There really aren't. Yeah, there really aren't. I went looking for more to compare it to. I got nowhere. But $105 million today is what this thing would bring.
A good comparison would be Charlie Brown's Thanksgiving special. I'd like to see how they compared.
They both have had long runs.
Yeah.
Still very good there. This entire story was inspired by a real life experience that John Hughes had. He had a very bad trip trying to get home one, I think, Thanksgiving, and ended up on a plane, a train, and an automobile to get there. Like all of his movies, though, home base is Chicago. So he's trying to get home to Chicago. I looked it up. I don't know how long the flight from New York to Wichita is, but if you drive from Wichita to St. Louis to Chicago, it's 740 miles. So I've driven a lot. You've driven a lot. I mean, that's, you can knock that out pretty easy in a day if you got a car.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah.
That's 10 hours. That's not too bad at all. But I don't want to screw up the movie with this. I read once that John Candy had said that when he read this script, it was the most perfect role ever made for him. He thought it was amazing. Ooh. Kevin Bacon is in the movie, and he's in the movie twice. Once on camera and once not. And I'll bet you know which it is. Do you know the scene where he's in it, but you don't see him? You hear him.
No.
When Neil's wife has the TV on and is asleep waiting for him, you hear a movie. And the movie is she's having a baby.
That's right. That's funny.
There was a scene in a strip club that was cut from the movie. I pulled this from some trivia. It says, after their car blew up, Neil and Dell went inside a strip club to use a phone, where Dell got distracted by the dancers. Actress Deborah Lamb didn't know that her scene was cut until she went to the screening of the movie.
Oh.
That's a bummer to find out.
That reminds me of the guy that played Darth Vader, not finding out that his voice was cut from Darth Vader until the screening of the movie.
That's not me. Yeah. Sounds like somebody else.
Has the whole family there and everything. Man.
Actress Jeri Ryan was cut from the movie, but her scene wasn't. And Jeri Ryan played Seven of Nine on Star Trek Voyager. It was her first role. She was one of the passengers on the bus, and she could not stop laughing at Steve Martin and John Candy. So they had to reshoot the scene with a different actress.
That's funny.
Couldn't take it anymore. John Candy arrived on set with exercise equipment. On the first day of shooting, the crew brought in treadmills, weights, and other exercise equipment for him to use in his hotel suite. Steve Martin says he didn't use any of it. None. And Steve Martin thought the script was too long. He said that the 145-page length of the script was a lot for a comedy. And when he asked John Hughes about it, about what scenes they thought they might cut, John Hughes was confused by the question. Martin later claimed that the first cut of Planes, Trains, and Automobiles was 4.5 hours long.
Well, and it's still a long movie.
It is. It's very long.
It's unnecessarily long. Like, if you cut it to the typical 105, 120 minutes, I don't know. Do you lose anything? What would you cut?
I don't know. It's so ingrained at this point. I don't want anything to disappear ever. I caught something this time that I'd never caught before. The scene when they're on the plane, on the Boeing, like in the very beginning. That's from Airplane. The exterior shot of the plane flying in the weather. Yeah, that's from Airplane. I pulled some facts on the car, on the Chrysler LeBaron, and it turns out it's not a Chrysler LeBaron.
Oh, it sure as hell looks like
one. It is, in fact, its cousin, a Dodge 600 convertible, modified with LeBaron grille, headlights, and taillights, and faux wood trim. And the enormous wire wheel covers were a joke, but I don't know why. Chrysler wanted nothing to do with this movie. They insisted that all semblance of anything with the Chrysler logo be removed. But I think there's still a couple in there. I think there's one on the steering wheel. I think at some point you see the owner's manual in the glove box. But the name of the car in the movie is the Grand Detroit Farm and Country Edition.
You think you hate it now? You drive it.
But where do you drive it?
Where do you drive? The color was chosen by John Hughes himself. It is the family truckster color, that green. It's unlikely anybody in their right mind would make a green car with red interior. It would be crazy.
It was the 80s.
There's a little trivia of somebody who tracks these cars that says, at one time during the building of the cars used in the movie, the studio owned all of the wood siding that Chrysler had in their parts inventory. Almost all of the parts were purchased from Claude Short Dodge in Santa Monica, California. Only one of the cars survived the filming and was repainted a cream color, and then as of 2009 was still in Los Angeles. Would you like
that? Not exactly a collector's item.
Man, such a weird car, but I loved this movie. I still love this movie. And I did pull a lot of clips from this movie, and there's a couple that we do have to play in here. But I thought it might be fun if the two of us reenacted a scene from this movie.
Okay.
So I have sent you a Google Doc, and we're going to reenact a scene in the middle of Neil and Del fight. Now, do you want to be Neil or do you want to be Del? You can pick.
Well, I think you're a bigger fan than I am, so I'm going to let you pick.
I'll start with Neil because that's at the top. Can you do all the John Candy laughs? Because I'm going to need that. I need you to do the... I'll be Neil, and we do have some music for this. Let me get this going here. Okay. Oh, okay. I missed it. All right, ready? Would you stop doing that with the seat?
Once you screw with these, you never get comfortable.
Well, quit screwing with it.
I'm getting comfortable. Do you have a bad back? Well, I do. And there's only a couple of good positions.
You're going to break it.
Done. Ah, lovely. Lovely, lovely. Ah, damn it.
What now?
I can't reach my feet to get my shoes off.
That's fine. Leave your shoes on.
I can't relax that way.
I don't care to breathe your foot odor.
It must be... It must be swell being so perfect and odor-free. Things about you bother me, but I'm decent enough not to bring them up.
No, yeah, what about me bothers you?
There's lots of things.
Name one.
You want me to name one? Fine. You play with your balls a lot.
I do not play with my balls.
Oh ho ho, Larry Bird doesn't do as much ball handling in one night as you do in an hour.
Are you trying to start a fight?
I'm simply stating a fact. You fidget with your nuts a lot.
You know what would make me happy?
Another couple of balls and an extra set of fingers.
Oh, that's humor. There's real humor. I'd be happy if you rested your mouth.
My pleasure.
I'd like a little silence.
No problem.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thus concludes our very first reenacted scene.
Tuna no crust. That's the next tuna one we no should do.
Okay. If this ends up being something people like, we can attempt to do this more often. This There is one clip that we do have to play in here, and we're going to hear it native. But Bernie can just go ahead and melt it. Bleep it? What's the right thing to say here? You'll figure it out here.
Oh, Jean Marie, you're a stitch. No, Mom's going to do the turkey. Yeah, Dad wants ambrosia, so I guess we got to get those miniature marshmallows. And I'll do the crescent rolls, and you do the cranberries. No, I can't cook. Yeah, well, I'll see you tomorrow then. Gobble, gobble.
Oh, we got to count them as we go here.
Bye-bye.
Are you counting?
I'll try to count. It's coming.
Welcome to Marathon. May I help you?
Yes.
How may I help you?
You can start by wiping that f***ing dumbass smile off your rosy f***ing cheeks. Then you can give me a f***ing automobile. A f***ing Datsun. A f***ing Toyota. A f***ing Mustang. A f***ing Buick. Four f***ing wheels and a seat.
I really don't care for the way you're speaking to me.
And I really don't care for the way your company left me in the middle of f***ing nowhere with f***ing keys to a f***ing car that isn't f***ing there. And I really didn't care to f***ing walk down a f***ing highway and across a f***ing runway to get back here to have you smile at my f***ing face. I want a f***ing car right now.
May I see your rental agreement?
I threw it away.
Oh, boy.
Oh, boy, what?
You're f***ed.
I see, so I have an accurate count. I had a pencil. 1, 2, 3, 4,
I think
five,
I got 18.
6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 19 F-bombs.
19?
In the span of a minute.
It's the perfect movie for Thanksgiving. Mm. See, you watch that at Thanksgiving, you can get along with anybody after you watch that one.
Oh, yeah.
That is a perfectly good one. I have many, many, many clips. The problem with this movie is that they're so long of setup. Like, even that one was longer than I wanted it to be, but it's so funny. There is, like, one clip that explains John Candy super well. I don't even think that they talk in it, but I'm just going to play the little opener of it. This is, like, when they have to spend their night together in the hotel room, but while they're trying to fall asleep.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Of all your roadkill trips, do you share a room or do you get your own room?
In the beginning of roadkill, we did share rooms. I think probably the first, I don't know, maybe the first season I did. After that, I think we became grown-ups and everybody had their own room.
Yeah. I've done a lot of business trips sharing rooms, and that's not the most fun. But this movie is as much a tearjerker as it is funny, but whenever I think of this, I mostly think of the funny. So I'm going to give this a perfect 10 turkey drumsticks with gravy, with pie, both pumpkin and French silk. That's how it's got to go. I love it.
Well done, sir. Well done.
That was the Kibbe and Finnegan Show back in the day review from episode 51 of Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. Again, we will do a whole nother deep dive over on the Patreon show in hour number two. But just a thank you to Aluma Trailers for presenting that review. You know, sometimes I ask sponsors where they would like priority in the show, and sometimes they just leave it up to us. And Aluma has been wonderful to work with. It's always our call. We always get to choose where that spot goes. I've really enjoyed getting to know them a little bit more. We did a neat interview with them, Iowa company here. But if Aluma is news to you, well, just go to alumaklm.com. They have utility trailers, ATV trailers, motorcycle trailers, car trailers, of course, but also snowmobile trailers, enclosed trailers for all sorts that you might be interested in. Again, most of us here are probably cars, but also motorcycles, watercraft, truck bed toppers, aluminum picnic tables. They got it all. 5-year warranty. Just go to alumaklm.com. And if you have a question about a custom product, go ahead and ask them. Tell them you heard them here on the podcast show. The only way that they know that people are listening to these ads is if you tell them that you did. So we would appreciate you doing that. Just go to patreon.com/KF Show if you'd like to hear hour two. Either way, have a wonderful Thanksgiving. Thank you for listening, of course. If you get the show on iTunes, leave a little rating there. Or if you have just a funny joke and you want us to read it on the air, throw it in iTunes and I'll do it. Alrighty? Happy Thanksgiving, everybody. See you later. Bye-bye.
Yeah, so, if I don't see you again...
Happy holidays.
Same to you.